Everybody, welcome to Transformation Tuesday Bible Study. Today we're going to be talking about spiritual warfare within the church and how to have victory over that. But before we begin, I'd like us to pray. In the name of Jesus, I pray that everybody watching comes to understand how important it is to pray for the church, to pray for spiritual warfare within the church. Because without unity, there's no way that we will be able to build up your kingdom the way that we're supposed to, or focus on things, because people are so disturbed by sensationalism, hyper-futurism, and all these things that honestly, at the end of the day, will not help us in occupying and redeeming the time and standing out and standing apart from the world and bringing more people into the body of Christ, Lord. Thank you, Lord, in the name of Jesus, amen. We'll be using the New King James Version of the Bible, but you can use any acceptable version. Let's begin. Let's open our Bibles to James chapter 1 verses 21 through 27. That's James chapter 1 verses 21 through 27. Therefore, lay aside all filthiness and overflow of wickedness and receive the meekness, the implanted word, which is able to save your souls. But be doers of the word and not hearers only, deceiving yourselves. For if anyone is a hearer of the word and not a doer, he is like a man observing his natural face in the mirror. For he observes himself, goes away, and immediately forgets what kind of man he was. But he who looks into the perfect law of liberty and continues in it, and is not a forgetful hearer, but a doer of the work, this one will be blessed in what he does. If anyone among you thinks he is religious and does not bridle his tongue, but deceives his own heart, this one's religion is useless. Pure and undefiled religion before God and the Father is this: to visit orphans and widows in their trouble and to keep oneself unspotted from the world. So as Christians, we have to be doers of the word. We have to actually exemplify the word, because there's actually a lot of people, since Jesus is famous, it's a lot of people who know who he is. When we misrepresent him, we do a disservice, okay? We do a disservice to God and his mission for us. We can't build the kingdom. We can't build the kingdom when we have churches that are full-on racist and they're okay with it. Or we have people dibbling and dabbling in New Age stuff or in witchcraft, okay? And they're okay with it because it meets their terms and their standards. Or people who are obsessed with the demonic. They don't know how to fight the demonic. They don't know how to pray against it, but all they do is talk about it. Or when there's wars going on, instead of us to pray for those wars to end, or for, you know, the Christians in that country, or for people in that country to be saved so that they can become Christian, meaning that they don't die, so that they still have a chance to meet Jesus, meaning become believers. We're not praying, we're egging it on. You want it to happen, and you're so happy because you think that this means that the tribulation is coming or that Jesus is coming back, which is foolish because you have not looked at history and seen how many wars there have been, how there's been the bubonic plague, how there was a whole age or ages called the Dark Ages that none of us would have survived in, to be honest. I know I wouldn't. And I bet most of the church would not have survived the Dark Ages. And here we are, we have this advantage where we can spread the gospel still. We're not being persecuted like Palestinian Christians or Chinese Christians. And here people are just playing these games, so to speak, and dibbling and dabbling in sensationalism, constantly comparing conspiracy theories to Bible prophecy. And most of the people who are talking about Bible prophecy don't even have the gift of prophecy, but they keep making these false predictions. And when we continue to cry like wolf like that, the public looks at us like we're crazy. How are you going to continue to go to work and stuff if this is on your mind and this is how your mind is thinking? Because you have this whole mindset of escapism, focusing on end times, focusing on the rapture, focusing on tribulation. It's a form of escapism. And then you're not going to focus on what he told us to do, which was occupy and redeem the time. Because guess what? In Paul's day, it was end times. All right? When Jesus died, it was end times, even then. So they were still focused on occupying and redeeming the time. They weren't spreading lies. They weren't spreading conspiracy theories. They weren't disrespecting their neighbor. they were still trying to expand the kingdom. And that is what we're called to be doing. We have to look like we rise above problems. We have to look like we have solutions to problems and actually have solutions instead of just barking them constantly and screaming and yelling. You're putting them in the atmosphere. You're putting them in the ether. You're making the enemy happy. And now he can just use that as a tool because you know what? You called yourself a Christian and you're not acting like it. So the church has to. We have to pray for the church to continue to do that, to continue to be repentant of their sins, to not allow certain things in their church. Okay? To not allow certain things in their church like sexual immorality. Okay? And then extremist behavior, rebellious behavior, and actually pushing that behavior. Churches should not be doing that. It's very clear what we should be doing right now, which is making disciples of all nations, focusing on whatever we have to do, whether that's housework or actual jobs, okay? Praying against any bad thing that happens in the world. Because guess what? Even with this whole Ukraine and Russia thing, we can make more disciples. We can help people, you know, who are Christian in the Ukraine. There's a lot of Christian Ukrainians, actually. There's a sizable amount of them. And instead of us praying for them and praying for their safety, people are overjoyed that there's a possible war. That's not what should be happening at all. And that's not how Christians should be behaving. And so when a non-Christian sees this, they're like, what is this? I don't want to be a part of a group like that. This is not the Christ that I read about in high school or in college. Because he is taught about. I don't care what your pastors tell you. There's a lot of people who know him. But the biggest problem right now is that the people who call themselves Christians misrepresent him. They're not living the word. They're running around with not a spirit of sound mind, but a spirit of fear all the time, okay? Meanwhile, these non-Christians are doing well in life. They're buying homes. They're living their life. They have jobs. They may have lost their jobs. They've gotten new ones. We're the ones who have the Holy Spirit, and yet a lot of them even sin less than Christians do. There's whole cultures where they don't participate in certain sins and that they don't even realize that that's what they're doing because it's just their moral code. And here we are, we can't even follow that. With the power of the Holy Spirit within us, that's a problem. That's a problem. And if non-Christians see this, they're not going to want to join the body of Christ. They're going to say that they act, that people who are Christians act crazy and they don't represent Christ. They don't even act like Paul. They don't act like Peter. They don't act like Mary, Elizabeth, Lydia, none of them, but their behavior. So it's very, very important that we actually live the word and be examples. That makes it so much easier for us to spread the gospel. And even if we are in hard times, we have to be able to rise above it. We don't have to do that with our own strength like other people are doing that are not in the body of Christ. We can rely on the power of the Holy Spirit. We can rely on God. We can pray to him. And we have to show that we do that and that we're level-headed and balanced. All right? Level-headed and balanced to people who are non-Christians. Because like I said, there's a lot of non-Christians that are living their lives. Or they were able to rise above everything that went on. Whether that was the disease issue or whether that's wars going on, they're able to rise above everything. Crypto crashing, that crashing, whatever crashing, changes in the world. They're able to move forward. We should be the ones able to move forward and give advice. And not be relying on things that aren't true in order to satisfy some fix. And we have the best fix in the world, and that's the Holy Spirit. So these are the things that we have to focus on. We have to live the word. We have to rise above these things. We have to guard our eye gates and our ear gates. We have to live repentant, and we have to be sinning less and less. That will show somebody like, wow, this person was able to rise above all this stuff going on, you know, and that person is a Christian. I want to find out more. I want to learn more. Or that person prayed for this war to end and it ended. I want to learn more about Christianity because that person is showing triumph in times of trouble. Not fear, not making up stories. Not crying wolf all the time and then, you know, the rapture doesn't happen or the tribulation doesn't happen. That's not what we're supposed to be doing. And the Bible doesn't call for us to do that. All right? Let's continue. So let's continue on in James chapter 5, verses 7 through 12. That's James chapter 5, verses 7 through 12. Therefore, be patient, brethren, until the coming of the Lord. See how the farmer waits for the precious fruit of the earth, waiting patiently for it until it receives the early and latter rain. You also be patient. Establish your hearts, for the coming of the Lord is at hand. Do not grumble against one another, brethren, lest you be condemned. Behold, the judge is standing at the door. My brethren, take the prophets who spoke in the name of the Lord as an example of suffering and patience. Indeed, we count them blessed who endure. You have heard of the perseverance of Job and seen the end intended by the Lord, that the Lord is very compassionate and merciful. But above all, my brethren, do not swear either by heaven or by earth or with any other oath, but let your yes be yes and your no, no, lest you fall into judgment. So as Christians, we're called to be patient and persevere to the end. What does that mean? We have to focus on our salvation in fear and trembling. We have to focus on things above and not anything beneath. We have to continue to be prayerful. If we have ministries, we're to steward them. We have to be giving to the poor. We have to help the poor, help the needy. We have to care about people's lives. That's from abortion and onwards. We have to care about all these things and pray against these things, all right? And take action. But if we do take action, it has to be appropriate and it has to be lawful, because God looks at those things too. And if you're working, you have to continue to excel at your job. If you're a man especially, and you have a family or you're not working, you need to find a job and ask the Lord to help you find one. Because God said, a man who does not provide for his family is worse than a non-believer. So that has to be done. These are all the things that we must do. And if we do these things, we will be blessed. In what we just read in the book of James, we see they talk about Job, who he endured everything. He endured all his suffering. And he was eventually blessed. Okay? He was so blessed after that. Because he continued to trust in God. He continued to believe in God. He continued to improve, and we have to continue to do that as well. We have to, no matter what's going on in the world, we have to rely on the Holy Spirit within us. We have to rely on God to continue to move and push forward, to guide us through anything. That can even be technological changes as well. We can't just jump at every single technological change. When the internet first came out, they thought WWW meant 666, the mark of the beast, and yet everybody here uses the internet, I'm pretty sure. So we can't just be frightened every single time there's a change. You have to understand the change, understand the implications, and find some middle ground and see, okay, this is the bad side of it. This is the okay side of it. This is the part where I'm going to stay in that's not going to push me into sin. Because guess what? You can still be sinful with the internet. You can still be sinful with your TV. But you could also watch your TV within limits. You can go online and research and do stuff that has nothing, that's not even sinful. So we have to be able to find middle ground. We have to continue to persevere until the end and work on our salvation. Our salvation is in fear and trembling. We have to continue to do all these things, and we will be blessed. All right. We have to show the Lord that we're patient, that we're not rushing him. We're not giving him a timeline. I mean, can you imagine? Jesus doesn't even know when he's returning, and yet there's people in the body of Christ creating timelines. It's ridiculous. It never worked. You can go and look up how many times people have guessed the wrong dates, created timelines, and it failed. And God just laughs, because you can't create a timeline. Only he knows. Only he knows. So that's why we are to occupy and redeem the time, be patient, and persevere until the end. Which means that the kingdom work does not stop. We have to continue to do all these things in order to build the kingdom, in order to be blessed. And even while we're suffering, even while we're going through things, we'll still be blessed in this time period. I know that even these past 2 years, I've still received blessings, even though there was a lot of struggle. But that's because I relied on the Lord, and I shut off a lot of things that I knew were not true, or I found out were not true. So I was able to move forward and have a clearer mind. So we have to be of sound mind. We have to continue to persevere and face anything through the power of the Holy Spirit within us. Pray, build solutions, bring solutions to the church, tune in to Pray for the Church, and we're going to talk about praying for the church next. So let's turn to Psalms 85 verses 1 through 13. That's Psalms 85 verses 1 through 13. Lord, you have been favorable to your land. You have brought back the captivity of Jacob. You have forgiven the iniquity of your people. You have covered all their sins, Selah. You have taken away all your wrath. You have turned from the fierceness of your anger. Restore us, O God, our salvation, and cause your anger towards us to cease. Will you be angry with us forever? Will you prolong your anger to all generations? Will you not revive us again that your people may rejoice in you? Show us your mercy, Lord, and grant us your salvation. I will hear what God the Lord will speak, for he will speak peace to his people and to his saints, but let them not turn back to folly. Surely his salvation is near to those who fear him, that glory may dwell in our land. Mercy and truth have met together. Righteousness and peace have kissed. Truth shall spring out of the earth, and righteousness shall look down from heaven. Yes, the Lord will give what is good, and our land will yield its increase. Righteousness will go before him, and shall make his footsteps our pathway. So we have to pray for the body of Christ and the church. The church is in a lot of error right now, and here actually the psalmist is remembering when the Lord led the Israelites to restoration from their captivity with the Babylonians because they were repentant and he forgave them of their sins. So he brought them favor and mercy and everything. And so we have to pray against the sins of the church right now. The church is involved in a lot of things that they should not be involved in, the church and the body of Christ. That includes a lot of different things: progressive Christianity, Christian nationalism, hyper-patriotism, hyper-futurism, okay, conspiracy theories, racism. They're involved in all sorts of things that are actually anti-Christ. Okay, they're engaging in anti-Christ behavior. So we have to pray for the church to repent of these things. We have to pray for them to repent of their spirit of fear. Ask the Lord to remove the spirit of fear that's moving amongst the church. Fear of change, economic changes, technological changes. We are supposed to be the church and we're supposed to rise above these things so that non-believers see that and want to join the body of Christ. This is exactly why the church is losing the culture war. It's because of our behavior. Again, like I said before, Jesus Christ is famous. Whether you know it or not, even non-believers know who he is, but they just don't believe yet. And a lot of them, if you ask them, what's stopping them from that belief is that Christians are not acting like Christ. They're not acting even remotely like Christ. We're knee-deep in sin and we're okay with it because we're labeled as Christians. Not good. We're repeating conspiracy theories as if they're prophecy when it's a lie. Conspiracy theory is very, very cheap. I'm sorry. You have to do some real research on stuff before you act like an expert on something and say that you're a member of the body of Christ and you're putting that out there. You have to be very careful of these things because God is watching everything. And right now, he is angry with the church. That's exactly why the church has no influence. Because the church is not acting like the church. They're not acting like the hands and feet of Christ. He had one command for us during end times. Okay, and that is to occupy and redeem the time. Whether that was in the 1970s, or that's in 2020, 2021, 2022, that's what we're supposed to be doing. So when there's crisis going on, and non-believers seem stronger than believers, that's exactly what the enemy wants, because then they run away from the church. Why would they want to join something that's going to bring them more anxiety, depression, fear? Or if they're run by narcissistic pastors, people who love themselves more than they love God and Christ, why would anybody in their right mind want to come and join that? They wouldn't want to. They wouldn't want to. Or people who are so forceful and hateful towards people who are non-believers instead of trying to give them the gospel or bring them into the body of Christ. realizing that you were a non-believer once yourself. So self-righteous behavior, you're acting like a Pharisee. God doesn't want us to do that either, because that pushes people away from the church. We're supposed to be the leaders. We're supposed to be the ones who are strong. And we don't have to rely on ourselves to do that. We can rely on the Holy Spirit. So it's important that we pray against all these things and for the church to realize this, the church at large, all members of the body of Christ to realize this, so that the Lord can restore us. People were wondering where the word revival comes from. It's in this psalm. So he can bring life back to the church. And our harvest can increase. What's our harvest? Believers. We can get more believers. If we're not sowing seeds, if we're sowing seeds of poison and lies and not focused, then who's going to want to join that? Nobody. And that's exactly what the enemy wants. He wants us stuck on conspiracy theories. He wants us doing newspaper theology, thinking that every single event is an end times event and means that Jesus is coming back soon or that the tribulation is coming. He wants us to do that. He wants us to engage in escapism. And we're not supposed to be engaging in escapism. That's for people who don't believe to do. But we're believers. We're supposed to rise above it. We're supposed to occupy and redeem the time until he comes and until we die. Because you know what? You don't know if you're going to die tomorrow. And yet you were engaging in all this activity that's actually deceiving the church and that's holding them back from what they need to be focused on right now. We need to be praying against wars, not pushing them. Right? We need to be praying for the Christians in China, the Christians in India, the Christians in Palestine that are being persecuted for their religion, really persecuted. And yet they're not screaming that the tribulation is coming tomorrow. They're not screaming that Jesus is coming back soon. They're continuing to give the gospel, even though they know they might die for it. That's what we need to be doing. Here we have the luxury. We're not even dying for it. And we're focused on things that don't matter. And it's poisoning the church. Cessationism, poisoning the church. Heresies are poisoning the church. People saying that people in the body of Christ who really feel like they need deliverance, you know, there's certain sins that they're still in bondage to. There's abuse that they endured. They want the trauma. They want to be delivered from that. And saying that the deliverance doesn't exist. Or saying that all deliverance ministries are bad when, of course, there's bad apples, yes, but it doesn't mean that deliverance ministry doesn't exist and it doesn't have a function. It does. As I've spoken about before, that is actually part of the gift of miracles. Being delivered from a stronghold is a miracle. Being delivered from sickness is a miracle. So we have to be able to do all these things. We have to continue to do all these things and pray for the church to come to repentance, the body of Christ to come to repentance. And then we'll see that we'll have that peace, that mercy, that grace from God, that glory. Our harvest will increase. And we have to continue to pray that the church focuses on what it should be focusing on, which is building the kingdom of God, praying against anything that happens in the world, helping the poor, helping people who need to get jobs actually get jobs, because we have to do that, you know, helping people be productive and become more and more like Christ, helping with discipleship, leading them in discipleship. That's what we should be focusing on right now. So we have to pray for the church to change their focus. We have to pray for that as well. And God will redeem the church. He will do that. He will bring us favor. He will increase our harvest. We will win the culture war if we do these things. So that's what this psalm is for. And I've been praying this psalm over the church, and I suggest that you do it too, or something that's similar, so that the church gets its focus back, gets its strength back, gets out of this whole spirit of fear that they have over them right now. We cannot look less Christ-like to the world if we want them to come to the body of Christ. We have to do it. Yes, you're supposed to be tough, but you're also supposed to be compassionate. We have to be balanced. If you are imbalanced, you should not be a pastor or preacher or anything, because you mislead the flock. Because they're all now, most of them are imbalanced. So it's very important that we are balanced and that we have our focus on what he wants us to focus on. Occupying and redeeming the time and enduring to the end. All right, let's continue. So we must continue to occupy and redeem the time and persevere until the end. That means being repentant, obedient to the Lord, also living the word, taking our discipleship classes if we have to. Okay, we have to continue to do these things that the Lord loves us doing in order to grow the body of Christ. If you're a minister, minister to people, both believers and non-believers. We have to continue to make disciples of all nations. These are things that we should be doing. Eliminate all distractions. Anything that you see is not focused on God or will lead somebody to God through Jesus Christ, eliminate that. And you'll see how much more peaceful your life is going to be. And continue to pray for the church and the church at large and the body of Christ. Now, mind you, what I said about churches, it's not all churches that are like this. There are some great churches out there that are doing great work. And that's exactly the ones that you should be giving to. So give to churches, give to ministers, give to the poor, the people who need it, like we're called to do. You want to make sure that you're doing these things. And then for churches that are deep in sin and are not good representations and unfortunately are the ones that are always in the forefront, always on TV, always selling books, we have to pray for them to come to repentance. We need to pray for their deliverance because we are losing. That's why we're losing the culture war. We're not going to win if we continue like this. So continue to keep them in their prayers and continue to pray about things in the world. Whether that's Christians being persecuted elsewhere, or even wars that are arising, pray against it. Pray for believers to come out of those wars. Pray for people's lives so they can actually become believers. These are the things that we should be focused on as the body of Christ. We're supposed to be the ones uplifting. We're the ones that they should be seeing as strong. Right, as people who can rise above anything, people who are victorious in everything, people who are more than conquerors, we are supposed to be that. Not people who are running around with the spirit of fear, constantly distracted, constantly running around in circles, never coming to a solution, barking all day. That's not what we want the world to see us as. So we need to pray against all these things. I want to thank you so much for joining us this week. On Friday, we will be having a special discussion with Shannon Savoy of Narc Free Living. We'll be talking about narcissism in the church. That is her specialty. She is a life coach, and she helps people who suffer from narcissism, especially spiritual, the ones who have been affected spiritually. That is her focus. Thank you so much for joining us. Have a blessed week.